I am here, as Dr. Anson said, to introduce this wonderful panel from the Fly Brave Foundation, which is a local nonprofit that was established a few years ago really to focus on the transition into adulthood and especially on maintaining social connections during that period. But specifically today, we're focusing on this aspect of Fly Brave, which is the public speaking program that actually kind of grew out of this other public speaking group that was running through the Mind Institute, this Toastmasters program. And actually, Drake and Jason, if you could wave to the crowd, were part of that group. Now, it was a time-limited group, but Matt, if you could also indicate yourself, thank you. Matt had the idea that Fly Brave could step in, and Matt actually has co-developed and been co-teaching this public speaking program through Fly Brave, and part of that program includes the Speakers Bureau of people who go to events like this in order to share their stories. And I think you'll find that these stories are quite different from the conventional story that we've traditionally told about autism. Traditionally, we've always tended to focus on the things that we think are wrong with autistic people, are absent in autistic people, the things that we identify as deficits. And that's a very negative focus that unfortunately leads us to have often a very negative outlook, a lot of fear for the future, despair even, this terror that this autistic child is going to grow up and not have a good life. And if there's much hope at all under this traditional approach, it tends to come, I think, from the idea that some neurotypical person is going to come in with an intervention to make the autistic person less autistic and more neurotypical. That is not the story that you are going to be hearing today. I think what you're going to be hearing today is that, yes, we have challenges. We are people with disabilities, which is not always easy, but we do have the potential to thrive, to have good quality of life, to have happy lives as autistic people. Not always easy, but possible. And the fact that this is a narrative that's coming from self-advocates, from the community, I think is so significant, because historically we know whenever one group is controlling everything that's said about another group, really doesn't tend to end so well. Whereas when a group has the ability to share its own perspective, then that gives it actually really some power over its own future, some ability to shape its own destiny. Some people have used the phrase to author one's own life. Through sharing one's perspective, you can actually exert some control over your future. So that is what I think we're here to do today. But I was told that I could say some things first. So before I introduce everybody else, you're just gonna have to suffer through more of me speaking. Sorry. That's me when I was about 11. That's when I was diagnosed as being autistic. You'll notice unusual social affect. That was mainly just because I hated having my picture taken back then. I had much more sensible, proper interests, like tropical cyclones, history, politics, and numerous other intense interests that I have had over the years, my current intense interest being, incidentally, autism research. Now, at this time, I would actually say that my main challenge was being an autistic person in the mainstream school environment. It was not working for me. For one thing, I had these very severe sensory sensitivities back then, and mainstream schools are nothing if not noisy. For another thing, there's the social connectedness piece, which wasn't working out, and not just because of bullying, which only ever involved a minority of people anyway, but really just because I didn't feel I had a lot in common with my neurotypical peers. And so I didn't want to be in the mainstream school. And fortunately, actually, I was able to get out of it. I was able to be homeschooled for a number of years, which worked much better. But this leads me to reflect on this concept we have of least restrictive environment. That's a term that we conventionally define to mean alongside non-disabled peers to the maximum extent that's deemed appropriate by some system. That is a very counterintuitive definition to me, because I understand restriction to be about denying an individual's preferences, stopping somebody from doing something that they want to do, or forcing them to do something that they don't want to do, such as forcing me to attend a mainstream school that I was experiencing as a restrictive environment. And I think there's many other people who've had similar experiences, who have been sort of suffering in silence in this school environment that's not working for them, but the school system doesn't perceive them to be disruptive or difficult, so as far as the school system is concerned, that's the right place for them. Conversely, there's a whole other group of people who are perceived by the system to be disruptive and difficult, and this is a group of people who are going to be forced out of the mainstream schools, whether they like it or not. So again, their preferences, their own self-determination is being ignored. They're not able to exercise their own self-determination. And I don't think that this is the right approach. And I think that this problem of self-determination is far, far broader. Don't get me wrong, there's been some progress. I'm very pleased, for example, that the regional centers are moving towards this self-determined model of support provision because, after all, who better than the individual most directly concerned to say what supports they actually need in their own lives? It just makes common sense, right? But unfortunately, there's still a huge amount of progress that still needs to happen. For example, as far as I'm aware, there is still no legal framework for supported decision making in the state of California, last time I checked. And even more broadly than this, I think we have a problem with the way that we set up the delivery of supports. We premise it all on this assumption, this idea that you have this person with deficits, this deficient person, this disordered person, who is petitioning for this expert neurotypical to kindly come in and assist them. It's a very disempowering way of providing services. It's demoralizing. It's probably disrespectful, I would say. And I don't think that it improves the effectiveness of the supports that we provide. I think the supports we provide would be much more effective if we were able to provide them on a more equal footing, in a more of a partnership kind of way. And I have one other thing, even broader, that I don't fully understand, that I thought I would share with you. So the way I see it, all people, whether we're neurotypical or not, whether we're neurotypical or neurodivergent, we all grow, we develop, we change, right? It's one of the nice things about being human. We're not static, we're dynamic creatures. Now, neurotypicals grow and develop and change, and nobody ever says that neurotypicals are disordered or deficient. Now, for some reason, we have this idea that if we call a neurodivergent person deficient and disordered, that this will help the neurodivergent person grow and develop and change in the way that we want. And I don't think that makes sense. I don't think that that is necessary. I don't even know that it's helpful in helping us to grow into our best selves. I don't see why we need that idea of disorder and deficit. Surely all people, whether they're neurotypical or neurodivergent, surely all people can expect others to accept them for who they are and as they are. Isn't that a basic human need? If you found this rant useful or interesting or helpful, there is definitely much more where that came from. As Dr. Anson said, I have a blog, autisticscholar.com, much more ranting there. Unfortunately, they only gave me a few minutes, and I'm sure that you all want to hear from the rest of the people on the panel. So I will stop hogging the microphone and invite Amanda Parker to please come up and author her own life. Please welcome Amanda. Thank you.
Good morning. I am happy to be here. My name is Amanda Parker. This is Jasmine. She is 5 years old. I am 30 years old. And an only child with two invisible disabilities, autism spectrum disorder and epileptic seizures and psychogenic non-epileptic seizures. I am proud to have been able to accomplish many different things, even though I have had many challenges with these disabilities. Although my mom noticed these differences when I was very young, I wasn't officially diagnosed until age 20. Throughout my early school years and college, I had difficulties. I never had a lot of friends. However, I did join band, choir, and sports. Looking back now, I understand why I was the way I was. My parents were my biggest supporters to help me get through school and especially through college. Extracurricular activities helped too. My proudest accomplishments were graduating from college and training Jasmine. In December of 2015, I graduated from Sacramento State with a BA in child development and a minor in music. I accomplished playing flute, and I really enjoyed it. It took me 9 years to achieve my degrees. With the support of my parents, especially my dad, and the program from Sac State, services to students with disabilities, which provided extra time on tests, a quiet place to take tests, note takers, and audiobooks. Training my service dog, Jasmine, was another accomplishment, giving me confidence and independence. However, it did not happen overnight. Seeing the service dog team of my friend Sarah and her dog Ginger inspired me to start my journey. She aids me with meltdowns and/or anxiety attacks by positioning herself in a manner that offers tactile stimulation to help me calm down. Jasmine will lay down wherever I point to and will act as a buffer between me and other people. Each day, she teaches me new things and is a continuous learning process. She also aids me in autism-related tasks, but now that I have epilepsy, she seems to be picking up on seizures. The resources in my community that help me tremendously are Fly Brave, Vanessa Beaker, which founded the nonprofit organization Fly Brave. Her wish is to provide events for young adults with on the spectrum. Some of the events are improvisation, public speaking, winter ball, swim parties, and jewelry making, and volunteering at the food bank. I have been both a mentor and a participant. Vanessa is also a mentor to me, and I value her. The Mind Institute and Center for Excellence in Developmental Disabilities has also provided me literature, the Resource Center, as well as groups such as Access, Acquiring Career, and Executive Control and Social Skills, and Women on the Spectrum group has also helped me. People from these two groups are also my friends and mentors today. Alto Regional Center has provided me with independent living skills with the goal of eventually living on my own. They also provide work skills too. And lastly, Special Olympics has offered me the opportunities to play basketball and soccer. This summer, I hope to play softball. It has helped me gain social skills and friendships. My future dreams are to live independently in a condo with transportation that is accessible to me and learn how to cook healthy meals and to have a job that is meaningful, to have a wide circle of friends and a significant other. It has been my pleasure of sharing my life with you. Come on, Jasmine.
To come up in front of this crowd of 300 people and just share your own personal story, it's such a huge amount of confidence and trust in us that you are demonstrating, and we really deeply appreciate that trust. Thank you so much. Next, please welcome John Almeda and his brother Anthony Zulli.
My name is Anthony, and behind me is my brother John. He is a professional runner who happens to have nonverbal autism. He's 25 and I'm 10. He just ran the Boston Marathon and he trained for his first 50-mile race, the American River 50. I'm going to play a movie for you about John's journey and then talk about what it's going to be like to be his brother.
like a small boat on the ocean, sending big waves into motion, like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. And all those things I didn't say were wrecking balls inside my brain. I will scream loud tonight. Can you hear my voice this time? This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove I'm alright song. My power's turned on. Stop me right now. I'll be strong. I'll play my fight song. And I don't really care if nobody else believes, 'cause I've still got a lot of fight left in me. Losing friends and I'm chasing sleep. Everybody's worried about me. In too deep, say I'm in too deep. In too deep. And it's been 2 years, I miss my home. But there's a fire burning in my bones. Still believe, yeah, I still believe. None of those things I didn't say, wrecking balls inside my brain. I was screaming.
Every single time I watch that, it just makes my soul dance. Thank you. Now, let's get right into it. People call me John Security Guard because I protect him. You see, there have been times before, like in the grocery store, John usually does his stemming, or he tap things twice before grabbing them. People laugh at him, and I'm always there. I mean, I give them the look. then I kindly explain that he has autism. Or mom does that, which you don't want her to do that for you. You know, when things would happen, yes, John is my brother, my friend, and my hero, man. John was diagnosed with autism at 18 months old. He's nonverbal. That doesn't mean that he can't hear you or understand you. It means that he doesn't use words to talk back, which gets him out of a lot of trouble. He uses an iPad, but he doesn't really like it. My mom wondered if this because he wanted to learn another way to talk to us. Now he's learning sign language and to type letters. That's big for us. That's really big. John works at Eschaton Senior Living and As a banquet assistant, he got his job through a pilot program with the UC Davis Mind Institute. He is so good at it, he secured a position after the pilot ended and had been working there almost 2 years now. John would like to publicly thank the Mind Institute for giving his career and that he loves so much. As for me, I love basketball, and I hope to make it to the NBA one day. I'm going pro, guys, I'm going pro. I know this is possible because I've watched my brother achieve his dream of running the Boston Marathon. John has more challenges than me, and I have watched my brother achieve his dream of running the Boston Marathon. John has more challenges than me, than I do. And he made his dream come true. Just because someone has autism doesn't mean they can't make their dreams possible too. I'd like to thank my brother for inspiring me and being fearless and to chase my dreams. I love you, John. And I'd like to thank our mom for driving us to all our practices, races, camps, and game, even though that she yells really loud on the sidelines. Bear with me. And I know she's just proud of us, Mom. We love you. John, I would like you to know that a diagnosis doesn't define you. Autism is your superpower. It helps him run fast, but it's not at all that he is. I mean, the reason why he runs fast is because he lives in the moment. Let's say with me, when I'm running, I'm like, okay, I got 2 miles left. When he's running, I'm just going straight for the finish. He doesn't care. And, I wish I had that superpower, man. That'd be awesome. I'd like to end with my favorite quote by Dr. Temple Grandin. You're different, not less. It means you're different, just not less than everybody. Isn't that cool? Just because you're different, you're not less. To me, you are so much more. And before I end this, I want to say, if you're a family member, a mom, a dad, a brother, a sister, anybody, keep trying. I mean, if it comes to running, to coding computers, to painting, just try it. I mean, anything is possible. John, all these people on the panel proved it by speaking in front of about 340 people right here. So, I mean, just thank you all for coming out and enjoy the rest of the speakers. Thank you.
Thank you so, so much, Anthony and John. My greatest terror before this was that I would be so busy tearing up now that I wouldn't be able to thank them properly. Fortunately, I think that I saw this enough in rehearsal that I'm a bit immune now, sort of, kind of semi-immune. But yeah. Such a moving story. Thank you. But now I have the pleasure of asking Drake Diaz-Covert to please come up and share his story. So please, everyone, welcome Drake. Thank you.
Well, hello, everyone, and welcome today. My name is Drake Mitchell Diaz-Covert. For those of you who do not know, autism is a neurodevelopmental disorder. It means, in simple terms, that my brain was wired differently. But if you take the time to think about it, all of our brains are wired differently. I'm currently at the age of 25. I graduated from Rosemont High School on June 5th of 2012 with a diploma. She figured out a way to teach me in a way that I would understand and learn. And it helped me to reach my goal. In 2008, I joined a little league called Challengers Little League. I played baseball from the year of 2008 to the year of 2012 while attending high school. Our team won numerous trophies, and when I would always go up to bat, I would always point my finger all the way out to the center field bleachers. Just like Babe Ruth did in the 1932 World Series when he called his shot. And I would always encourage all my teammates. We weren't always winning, but but at least we all went out there and had fun and did our best. I attended the Mind Institute's Access Program in the spring of 2016. I learned many things and techniques. Like, for instance, I learned about the term called thinking traps, which is basically unrealistic thoughts, and I would replace them with realistic thoughts and show them who's boss. I currently have a black belt in the martial art called Taekwondo. It took me over 7 years to achieve that goal, but I did it. Since 2013, I have retired from Taekwondo because it just wasn't for me. My grandmother was actually the one who inspired me or encouraged me to take up martial arts. It was to help me with my posture, and it helped me to keep my eyes open and have my head up. My instructor told me that if I did not stand up straight, that people would look at, that I would get hit in the face. That technique worked, and now, I know, laugh it up. But it worked, and I currently now have good posture, and I have better eye contact than I did in the past. When I was younger, I used to be very noise sensitive to certain things, like the sound of sirens, flies, and thunder and lightning. And I'm sure, among other things as well. Now that I'm older, I'm not so noise sensitive anymore. I have dealt with some of them, and I have outgrown others. I have obsessive compulsive disorder, OCD, anxiety, and attention deficit disorder, or ADD. Just like a lot of neurotypical people, I currently take medications for that. My mother asked me recently if I realized if I was a little different from the other kids growing up. I told her no. I never realized it. It wasn't until the age of 12 or around that time that she told me that I was different. Now that I'm older, I'm a lot more aware of my differences, and I know that I have one of the most difficult parts of my disability is that it's hard for me to sympathize and to empathize with other people. I really want to. I just find it extremely difficult. Most people find it very difficult to understand what they can't see, and that's why I think it is very important that we all should follow by the golden rule. You treat others the way you want to be treated. Because in the end, whether we have a disability or not, it has absolutely nothing to do with who we are as people. And it's all about kindness and respect. I thank you.
Thank you so much, Drake. I really, really appreciate, you know, how authentic and honest the stories that you're telling are. Thank you so much for that. It's really, really appreciated. Please welcome Jason Guillaume to share his story.
My name is Jason Guillaume. I am 21 years old, a high school graduate, an artist, a musician, and an athlete. I am also autistic and struggle with severe receptive and expressive language disorder. By the time I was 8, I could string short, simple sentences together, but I had trouble processing information spoken to me. This made it difficult to make friends because I was slow to respond their questions or comments. To improve my social skills, I was signed up for a lot of sports growing up. I played Little League and soccer, but never made any friends. I was always the only one on my team that had ASD. My teammates didn't know how to communicate with me, so my older brother Ethan was usually my translator. As a child, I was very responsive to music and was given music lessons early on. I eventually learned how to play many instruments, the piano, the saxophone, trombone, and tuba. Most of my learning was done by listening and imitating. I learned to play the piano proficiently, Using the Suzuki method, a non-traditional way of learning music through listening, imitating, and repetition. Unfortunately, I never mastered that traditional way of reading sheet music. Throughout most of my time in school, I was bullied. As I got older, my parents were worried and wanted me to learn how to protect myself. I was enrolled in Taekwondo. I trained 2 and 3 times a week for 10 years, eventually earning my black belt in the first degree. It was a great accomplishment. Even with this accomplishment, life was still lonely. My fellow black belt peers didn't know how to communicate with me, nor did my classmates. In high school, I still didn't have any friends, even though I knew how to play many instruments. I was able to join the band because of my inability to read music. Throughout most of my time in school, I ate lunch alone. I would use that time to draw and listen to music. Drawing allowed me to escape reality and create a world where I was surrounded by allies and not enemies. This is how I came a creating Mortal Universe, my comic about Rotoman. The superhero who saves the people from evil, Rotoman has many friends, and he's strong and brave. He was created a short of reflection on myself, because brave is who I am. I am thankful for creating Mortal Universe. It got me through the loneliness of high school. After 4 long years of feeling alone, it was graduation time. Graduation day was epic. When they called my name, I positively breakdancing on the way to accept my diploma. My surprise, I got a standing ovation. Since graduation from high school, I've been attending Meristem. The Meristem is a unique apprenticeship program that teaches adults with ASD transferable life and work skills. After 3 years, students are either ready to go to work or go to college. Meristem has both a residential program and day program. The residential program allows students to live on campus and experiments independence. The day program is open to students who still want to live at home but attending daily classes from 8:30 to 3:30 p.m. I have been attending the day program for the past 2 years. The community and the environment at Meristem is peaceful and inclusive for the first time in my life. I feel like part of a community and can just be myself. At Meristem, my classes have included body movement, culinary arts, digital art, glass bowling, woodworking, holoculture, and so much more. In glass bowling, I've made several bowls, vases, cups, and random art. In woodworking, I made a small dresser. In digital arts, I'm learning how to transfer my comics to digital format. These classes are giving me more confidence in my ability to become an artist. In addition to attending Meristem, I am also an athlete with the Special Olympics. I have been a Special Olympics athlete for the past year. I am no longer the only one with ASD on the team. Being a Special Olympics athlete has taught me more about own strengths and personal endurance. I'm making a lot of friends and having fun. Someday I hope to go to college and gain the skills I need to become a professional artist. I know if I keep persevering, all of my dreams will come true. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. Jason, and I absolutely agree with you that Rotoman bravery that has brought you so far, I am sure that if you keep persevering, you will make all those dreams a reality. I'm certain of it. But last but not least, please welcome Matt Harmetz, who, as I mentioned before, he's actually been co-developing and co-teaching this whole public speaking program.
Thank you, Patrick, for the introduction, and thank you all of you for being here. It really means a lot that to be speaking to such a large audience right now. It's really meaningful that so many people care about autism and really just want to help support people who do have autism. So thank you all for coming. So just a little introduction of who I am. My name is Matt Harmetz. I graduated from UC Berkeley, and I majored in Asian history and literature. I graduated in the summer of 2016. And for me, academics, while they were challenging, they were nowhere near as challenging as assimilating socially. And as a desire and need to assimilate, I ended up accepting a job at Aria Hotel in Las Vegas. And it was a job that really played to all my weaknesses rather than my strengths. It was an environment that's very multitask-based, and for someone like me with autism, I have very poor executive function, and I have a hard enough time single-tasking. So you could imagine how difficult it is to multitask, go from one task to another. It was a nightmare. Of course, it was very fast-paced. I really had no breaks. I had to go from one thing to another. As I mentioned, required good executive function, which I lack. It's a very social environment, and as someone with autism, I wouldn't say I'm the most social person ever. And of course, I had to pick up on social cues when interacting with customers or just even other coworkers. I had to always pick up on social cues, and I generally failed really miserably at that, fortunately. Additionally, it also required good fine motor skills, and I have another disability called dyspraxia, and basically it's a disability that impacts my motor skills. So even very simple tasks, such as maybe using a bottle opener, something like that is something that I have to actually learn. I don't learn that naturally. Someone has to actually show me how to do something like that. And I remember on the job, just there were like a lot of instances that just didn't go the way I wanted to. I remember even just putting on latex gloves is something that's really difficult for me. I don't have very many sensory issues, but latex gloves is the one thing that I just can't do. When I put my hands in there, it just feels really gooey, and I just can't get my fingers in all the way, and it just doesn't feel good. I remember when I was with the housekeeping department at Aria, they wanted me to help clean, and it wasn't that I didn't want to help them, but like I had trouble putting on the gloves, and I remember they were just like, oh, it's okay, don't worry about it, and I just felt so embarrassed because I actually did want to help, but I couldn't because of that. I also remember another incident when I was on the job. I was speaking to a guest, and I was just really anxious at the time. I said hi, and I was really nervous, and I remember the guest, as she was walking away, she muttered under her breath, idiot, and it made me feel really horrible just to hear someone say something so impersonal like that to me when I was really trying my hardest. Ultimately, the job didn't really last very long. I only lasted there for about 3 months. But I didn't want to quit. I struggled, and even though I knew that it wasn't really the job for me after just 1 month, I stayed there because, first of all, my dad's friend helped me get the job. I didn't want to disappoint my dad, nor his friend, nor my family. And also, I was also hoping to write a book about my experiences while on the job. I felt that I was in a very unique position, and not many people with autism are probably working in a really crazy environment like in Vegas, and I thought that I'd be able to write a very interesting story that could help inspire people. Eventually, I would realize that people weren't out to get me, and it wasn't really anyone else's fault that things didn't work out. It just wasn't the right place for me, and unfortunately, they just didn't have the personnel there to really support me. They don't really have people who understand autism or dyspraxia very well, and most people most likely opt out of that industry if they do have autism. I remember returning home, and I just felt immediate regret. I felt like I had disappointed everyone. I'd let myself down. I'd let my family down. I let my friends down, and I just went into a major depression episode, and I remember feeling just hopeless. I didn't know what to do. I felt my life had essentially ended. I remember lying in bed, just staring at the ceiling, and it felt like there was an invisible rock on top of me. I felt like I just couldn't get up. I remember trying to get out of bed every morning, and I just felt like I was paralyzed. It was just really incredibly painful for me. I didn't even enjoy my hobbies anymore. I didn't enjoy watching anime anymore. I didn't enjoy playing video games or just really doing anything. I just didn't know what to do. So I just really just stood there and I was very stagnant. I had to feign that I was okay at home to not cause my mother any more grief. And I really felt more suicidal than ever. Fortunately, I eventually was able to get out of that period. I met with a psychiatrist and joined a group for people with similar brain issues, some who also have autism, some who have ADD, among other disabilities. And at first, I didn't think much of attending that group. I didn't know whether it would help me. I'd really just given up already. But that group helped me tremendously. I realized that other people there also had similar issues as well, and that I wasn't the only one going through my difficulties. Other people had their own struggles as well. I also remember reading books about others with autism. I still want to write a book, and I wanted to read the book, wanted to read books about others because I wanted to see how others had overcome their own difficult situations. And also just, of course, I also wanted to see how people frame their own book so that I could write my own book in the future as well. I remember as I was getting out of my depression period, I started playing an online game, a really old game, and it was mostly due to nostalgia and just a way to cope with my depression. And fortunately, that actually worked really well because I met a lot of people on there, and for some reason, people online, they're generally more open, maybe because there's not a face-to-face interaction, but they opened up a lot, and I learned that people on there, they were going through a lot of difficult situations themselves, and it made me feel like I was not alone, which was really meaningful to me. I also met my first, I guess I could say, true group of friends on there. I've had friends here and there, but I haven't really had a group of friends like that, so that was my first group of friends online, which, again, was really meaningful to me. I started bonding more with my younger brother. We would go to happy hour when he is at home, and we would just go to bars and just get food, and it was really nice. I never had a bad relationship with my brother, but I wouldn't say I ever got along incredibly well with him, so it was nice just trying to get a little, bond a little bit more with him. And I remember, although I was recovering still at that point, I remember my mom told me that, okay, there's this another program called Access, which some of the other panelists have also attended themselves. And I remember thinking at first, I don't see what's the point of going to another group. I'm already attending one weekly. It just doesn't seem necessary. But that was actually the best probably decision in my life. I'm really glad I had done so. As part of the program, we had to volunteer if we weren't currently working, and I wasn't working at the time. So I ended up volunteering for Fly Brave, and really that's how everything got started here. I ended up joining Fly Brave. I ended up teaching this class, and I remember, it's funny, just having met Vanessa, I remember I told her that I wanted to do something that has to do with public speaking, and I had no idea that I would actually be leading this class. I originally just thought that I would be one of the students as well, and I'm just so thankful that I had this opportunity to teach the class. I've grown so much from it. I've learned just that I could actually go out here and speak to a large crowd of people. I could actually teach, and it's just really empowering for me. I remember improving my relationship with my mother as well when we attended the Access program to there. She learned a lot about me, which was really nice. And one other big thing that happened, I remember, was I went to Vancouver. It was during the Access program, and I never got along with my brother's girlfriend at all. I'd probably known her for years, and I basically hadn't spoken a word to her for years. But I remember going on that trip. She was there. I had to force myself to talk to her, and while I wouldn't say she's my best friend or anything now, I am on a speaking basis with her. So that was a big improvement for me. I'm really glad that I got over that hurdle. I remember meeting Vanessa's husband, John, and actually, he's a public speaker himself. He's more of an instructor, but having met him was also a very significant part of my life because, first of all, he really encouraged me to be doing what I'm doing. He's taught me so much, and I know I wouldn't be here had I not met John, so I'm so thankful for that. He's been just helping me out with my own personal endeavors, giving me advice, and just having taught the class with him, it's just done so much for me because his enthusiasm, his just excitement for teaching and helping people has just really rubbed off on me, and I feel like I am really, I'm really just inspired by that. And just having taught the classes, I just realized that I actually do have a talent for speaking, I have a talent for teaching, and that's something that I never would have realized before, and it really makes me thankful that I finally found something that I feel like I'm good at, something that I enjoy. I remember after the first class, I was told I was just complimented by everyone, and that felt so good to me, just seeing so many people praise me, the parents, the students, Vanessa, John. It was just a really great feeling for me. And I just noticed that at that point, I just became a lot more of a happy person. I've always been a pessimist. I've never looked at the bright side, but I think finally I've started to kind of see the light. I see that not everything is dark, that there is hope on the other side, that there is hope on the other side of the tunnel. And now, actually, I would say that I'm probably the happiest I've ever been in my life. I'm finally moving forward in life. I see that I do have a career in speaking. I have a career in possibly teaching, and I really do want to educate everyone around the world. I want to travel across the world someday, just really teaching people about autism, talking about my own personal experiences, really just inspiring, giving hope to people that even though you have a disability, it's not the end of the world. You can't overcome your challenges. Everyone's good at something. They just have to find it. And I remember initially my parents didn't really think much of me becoming a speaker. They were like, okay, can you really do that? Do you really have the ability to do so? And I understood because it's not a traditional job. You don't go on the internet and just search up public speaker and you apply to it. It's something that you really have to build, you have to really build towards. It's something that, you know, you have to do yourself. But I think it was after the first event that we had last December at the Mind that they really saw I have a talent for speaking, and that's when they really began to support me, which I'm really thankful of. And in conclusion, I think I finally began to accept myself for who I am. I remember always hating myself for having autism. Now I'm not really even, I'm not mad about that at all. It's part of who I am. I would be a completely different person if I don't have autism, and I am really happy with the person I am now. So I would actually like to say that I am happy that I do have autism now. And another thing to say, try not to let your weaknesses overwhelm you. Everyone has their strengths, they just have to find it. And really, this message doesn't apply just to those with disabilities, really it applies to everyone. And one last thing, life is precious, and we need to be compassionate not only to others, but also ourselves. Thank you. Oh, and I guess just one last real quick note. I have my website, mattharmetz.com. You could contact me directly on there, and we could be in touch via email. Thank you.
Overall, just such an awesome presentation, but I especially wanted to thank you for speaking so openly and courageously about mental health, which is still such a stigmatized topic, yet so, so important in the community. Certainly something that I've struggled with in the past, severe anxieties for one thing when I was younger, and it comes up all the time in the peer support group of students I facilitate at UC Davis, so we really do need to have that open and frank and non-stigmatized conversation, and thank you for getting that started.
My name is Geraldine. I have two kids with autism, and I'd like to ask Jason the name of, I couldn't understand the name of the school that you said you can live there or attend the day program.
That is true.
Hello? Oh, well, yeah, it is true. Meristem is a day program, so I'm a day program.
Sorry, how do you spell the name? Meris?
Meristem. Oh. It's M-E-R. It's Meristem. Is I-T-S-T.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
The other question I have is, I have a son who's 10 and has exactly the same issue that you experienced at 8 years old, and I am trying to find help for him, and I don't know what to do. What help did you get? Because it feels like he's stuck in a box, and as soon as you break that box, then he'll be able to speak so eloquently like you just did. Can you tell me what helped you, please?
Well, that's a good question. I did that for like researching for speaking skills after I helped them. And then I did that for like last year. That was like 6 months ago. And then I was helping for them. And then the teachers will help me too. Well, maybe because there will be like cooperativity to each other, like speaking clearly, and to be responsive to your brains or our brains, like responsibilities to make them share. And then I think I remember it was probably like a great accomplishment what they talking about. I tried everything that they all can.
Oh, there's a question. I suppose one downside of this flapping applause is that it's hard to see who's asking questions and who isn't. I didn't think of that beforehand. Oh, well.
Hi, gentlemen. My name is Jessica. I want to thank you, each and every one of you, for sharing your story. You have impacted me in a way that I didn't think possible. So thank you for sharing. It really means a lot. I have an 8-year-old son that was diagnosed on the spectrum at 2, and he's currently struggling to make friends. So I could really relate a little bit to what everyone is saying. My question, I guess, is for everyone. This is a broad one. what can I do as a parent to help facilitate friendships in a neurotypical classroom? Because he's really struggling, really struggling. And I mean that in the most compassionate way possible.
Well, that's a very good question. I think, like for starters, you can also you can encourage him to be more open with people. You know, I mean, like one of the lessons that my mother taught me in life and how to interact with people is just to be yourself and just be honest with them. And just by being yourself, you know, you can open up to new possibilities, and that you can also, you know, when you're being honest with people, when you first meet them, it helps to build a long-lasting relationship.
Well, when John was a kid, my mom really encouraged him to get out the house because they actually met Temple Grandin one time, and the more you get out the house, the more he realizes the area around him. And I mean, if you get him to do a hobby, or if you get him to have something that he really, really likes, maybe he could share that with people who have the same interests, like, say, video games. A bunch of people love video games, and so they could all play together, and that's how they could make friends. I mean, I don't know. It goes on and on.
Those are both such good answers. Just be yourself, and if you aren't accepted for yourself, then go out and find people who will accept you. But I mean, we're trying to keep it to sort of like a two answer rule just for, well, I guess we have time. Why don't you go ahead? Yeah.
Is he in band or choir?
He's in third grade now, so he's going to start. He's really, really excited about that. Really excited.
If he joins band or choir, that might be a good way to have him have friendships.
I think his problem is he talks older than he really is, so he doesn't have anything in common with third graders. Does that make sense?
Mm.
So he feels isolated and very alone.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's such a difficult issue, but yeah, I mean, it's just finding the right peer group. Yeah. Yeah. You know, it's a good question. I see another question here. I think it's your turn.
So my question is kind of for all of you. I have an autistic son who has experienced very much what you all have said, the isolation, the loneliness, the depression, the anxiety. But right now we're going through a phase with him of rages. He has anger that is, I don't know if it's repressed, where it's coming from, what it's stemming from. I can't seem to reach him during these times, and I don't know how to help him through it. But he will get so angry and enraged where things are flying and it's out of control, and he feels out of control, and then he beats himself up afterwards, how stupid he is, how he should kill himself, and these kind of things. And if you can offer any help, I'm very open.
Do his fits of rage come very often?
Pretty frequently, actually, yes.
Well, I would say the best advice for that would be for him. You see, when I was younger, I also struggled with a few anger issues of myself. And more specifically, my mother enrolled me in anger management classes. And it's helped me to have better control over my temper. And I did it. I graduated from it, got a certificate of completion, and I've improved over the years. And I would say maybe you can think about enrolling him in anger management classes to help him improve and help him control his temper a little better.
And if I could sneak in, because I actually did have some of the same thing when I was younger as well, some real meltdown episodes, I would really also think about what sort of of things might maybe be overloading him, what demands in his environment might just be too much, because, you know, often it can be a sign of exhaustion or some kind of mental health thing or something, somebody who's just really in a desperate position and maybe addressing some of those demands in the environment might be helpful. And is there anything else that's like super pertinent and helpful? Yeah, Matt.
I was just gonna say, like, at least for me, I also had a lot of anger issues when I was younger, and I think a lot of that stems from just frustration of having autism, just things just not working out. And I think if you can solve some of those issues, that would also help solve the anger issues as well. And I think going along with that, what might be helpful is trying to see if he could meet friends or people who have similar interests to what he has. That's probably the best way. And even if it's just one friend, I have one good friend that I've had since childhood, and that helps a lot, even if it's just one person. And if they could share hobbies, I think that will help a lot of things, and gradually that should really help his anger subside too.
Hi, I have a two-part question. The first part is, how do you know when you keep encouraging something? Like, society will tell you, you guys can't do this, you shouldn't do that. How do you know even when you are frustrated? My little brother's 15 and he has autism. How do we know when to keep pushing him even though he's frustrated or people may be laughing or he's not getting it at the same time without upsetting him even more and knowing that he just doesn't want to do it anymore?
That's a very good question.
It's a very, very great question. Honestly, growing up with John, I mean, sometimes if you push him into society, yes, he can get overloaded, but if you... That's a really good question, but... yeah, I can't really answer that right now. Maybe at break I will.
I think to answer that question, I think in a way to, well, you know, encourage him in a way that doesn't upset him. Well, first, I think for as a precaution, you should, you know, look out, you know, you should be aware of, you know, your choice of words in a way that doesn't upset him. But at the same time, though, you can also just mostly keep on encouraging him because, you know, because, you know, whether he has a disability or not, it doesn't define who he is. And he should actually embrace his disability and let him know that he's not the only, and just let him know that he's not the only one in this world who has autism.
And I'm totally breaking my rule about, you know, two people only answering the question, but I think to add to that, one thing that I find really concerning is that often people really come to depend on a lot of other people providing structure and direction. And so one thing that I think is really important, especially if people are like 16 and getting close to adulthood, is that they should really be demonstrating some leadership, starting to take a role in, you know, making decisions, going to their IEP meetings, thinking about what they want to do in life. And maybe if somebody can get some, you know, plans, some career ambitions, some goals, something to work towards, then maybe they can get some, you know, self intrinsic motivation to work towards those goals.
I had the second part.
Oh, yes.
How do you know when to, I don't know what you would call them, but I can say, I guess, undesired behaviors. Like, I notice sometimes he'll talk to himself in public, and when he finds out people are watching him, it embarrasses him. But I think it's part of his coping skill to talk himself down when he's anxious. So is it safe to just tell him he can go to a quiet place? He doesn't have to do it to the open, or will that frustrate him that he just can't do it anywhere at any time?
You know, this is getting to the point where it's like, you know, this is a specific person who we've never met. And I mean, some people, they might, you know, respond different ways to that kind of feedback. So I don't know how easily we can answer that one, unfortunately. It's a great question, but I don't want to steer you wrong, and we've never met this person, so. Yes.
Thank you, all the panelists, for sharing your such inspirational stories. My question is specifically for Jason. Jason, your experience at Marystem is very interesting. I'd like to hear a little bit more about what your favorite class and how that helped you, what you gained from it, if you can share that with us.
Well, that's a really good question. It's about the adulthood. Well, it makes you very helpful, called the hobby. Well, the hobby will make you very smarter every time you have to go outside and play sports and everything, or perhaps proficiently, like walking on the track, like a Monday walk. And the most importantly is how you talk to them for yourself, like adults, friends, and something like that. We have snacks, we have a perfect lunch, and it was like a nice view outside. And there's like a whole lot of different classes in each time. I respect that. Yeah. It's for like 2 and 3 years only.
Do you have, I think over here.
Over here. Where? Over here.
Go ahead.
Hi, thank you for sharing, everybody. I have a 17-year-old daughter on the spectrum, and if anyone can speak more to any of the social groups. She's 17, very highly socially motivated, wants to make friends, but has difficulty maintaining those friendships. So you mentioned the access. Are there any other, you know, resources that you found as you went from high school, especially transitioning, where you found your social group? Any advice or resources that you're aware of, or groups that you joined that you found helpful?
Well, I'm pretty sure everybody's came to our improv and Fly Brave. I'm not asking you to join or anything, but it encounters other adults with autism, and it's just great. It just puts all these people in a room to play games, and it's a really good aspect.
There's CASA Self-Advocacy Network.
Yeah, that's the Autism Self-Advocacy Group in Sacramento. Any others that come to mind?
There's also the Rock On Club as well.
And I'm sure that other people too, if anybody has some ideas, then maybe you can find one another at break. Well, why don't you stand up so that everybody can see who you are, so that anybody who has a relevant group can like find you. Yeah.
I think there's one more.
Great. And question.
Yeah. My question is for the parents. At what age did you guys, or when did you guys know it was a good time to let your child know that they had a, I don't want to call it disability, but they actually were, their brains work differently. I have a highly functioning 8-year-old. So I'm just trying to wonder, when was the best time to kind of let him know that he is, you know, different?
I'm Vanessa. I'm John and Anthony's mom right here. And when John was diagnosed at 18 months, as he started getting older, I started talking to him about autism. There was no Hey Google in the time that he was diagnosed, so he would go to the library with me to read books, and we would write Temple Grandin letters all the time because that's who I had to look up to. And so John, we've seen all of the movies about autism, and I've always told him, John, you have autism, this is a special gift, you have these special talents and traits, but when the kids at the park aren't playing with you, it's because they don't understand this power that is locked within you, so it is up to us to spread that awareness and teach them how to do that. So he's known since he was just a little guy.
Yeah, I really think that's a great way of dealing with it. You want people to have a positive sense of their self as an autistic person, a positive identity, and that means approaching it as just something that's true and natural and positive, and not making it this sort of big, you know, fearful, horror, shameful thing, which really sends, I think, the wrong message. So I'd encourage you to be very open and positive about it.
And did you want to share?
Yeah. Okay. I'm Lori, I'm Drake's mom, and for me, For me, it was, you know your child and you know what they understand. And I always told Drake he was special. And as he got older, just started filling him in little by little more and more about what autism was and what that meant and how he was being treated by people and that it was something that he was gonna have all through his life, but that didn't matter because he was who he was and that's how he was born. So.
Well said, well said. I think we have time for a couple more questions. One over here, I think.
Thank you, everyone, for sharing your story with us. It has been really moving. My question is to John and Anthony. I have a daughter, 18 years old, with Angelman syndrome, and she's nonverbal. John, how are you able to express your wants and needs and you know, what bothers you? How do you communicate with your family?
Well, how John, I broke his iPad, but nobody said that. You didn't hear that. He used to have an iPad, and he downloaded the app, and so there was all these pictures with words below, and he would tap on it, and it would say the word. And that really, really helped us, but for some reason, he didn't like to use it. I mean, but it just really, oh, that's a question for you now? Okay.
Hashtag boy mom, right, ladies? I just wanted to follow up on the brilliant answer my son had is for John. He used to use pecs, and as they get older in school, they kind of direct them to use more updated technology like ProloQ on the iPad, but he still really likes pecs, picture exchange communication system. The iPad, it was very hard for him to kind of navigate through everything, but he's actually learning sign language now, and even though John is nonverbal, he has no problem expressing himself. He takes Lyft on his own. He ran the Boston Marathon. He's running a 50-mile race. He goes to work on his own. He has a girlfriend. They go to the movies on their own. I mean,
all
he has nonverbal autism, limitless. Limitless. So.
I mean, at the fair, they go off and do their own things. Like, this is amazing. I mean, he has grown up so far. I mean, okay. You love everybody, right?
Yeah.
What's your name again?
I
am John. Okay, thank you.
I have a solution for the mom whose child is very much embarrassed by talking to himself and people are looking at him. He just comes into the 21st century, picks up a cell phone, and he just has to take the cell phone, put it against his ear, and it doesn't have to be on. But he can talk to himself all he wants, and everybody will think that's perfectly normal.
I like it. Wonderful idea. How clever. Yeah. And best of all, that was such a short question that we have time for, I think, one last more.
My question is for Amanda. So your service dog, what's the process that you went through to start and what did it take to train your dog, and how could we be successful in facilitating that for our children?
I went through a service dog trainer, owner trainer, and I had them help me pick out my own service dog. And then I paid them to help me train them. It was a long process, but it was successful.
The UC Davis Mind Institute was created in 1998 with a promise to find cures for neurodevelopmental disorders. Every day, our physicians and researchers come closer to fulfilling that promise. Their groundbreaking research on autism, Fragile X syndrome, chromosome 22q11.2 deletion syndrome, ADHD, and other brain disorders are helping children achieve their fullest potential. Please visit our website to find out more about current studies upcoming events, and how you can help make a difference.